block a lot of these connections out to social media sites or cloud services. Now, when I look at security, when I first started in software as a service, I think some of you will find this entertaining. I was working for WebEx, and WebEx actually hired me because there was a defacement, a web page defacement. And if some of you are familiar with WebEx, the way WebEx works is you have the company name .webex.com. And at the time, we had about close to 1,000 customers worldwide. This made it on the public news, so this is all public, and you can do search on it on Google. And the page was defaced to fuck the USA government. That's what it said, every single page. We had to tell the team to turn it off, close it out, and then we'll go in and fix it. So we started fixing it, or replacing the web page back from backup, and the pages started coming back again. The defacement started coming back in again. We didn't understand what it was that was doing it. Finally, we figured out that it was a vulnerability that was being exploited on the Windows system that we had to update or patch for. And the patching took some time because there were some dependencies. So all in all, it was about 48 hours that the site was down. A lot of customers were upset. One or two maybe left, but some of them continued to stay. And what was interesting about that is that a lot of the customers decided to stay because they didn't have any other company out there that they can go to that does something similar. They just stayed with us. And they were happy with the way we implemented the change. So also looking at some of the other interesting parts about running a security program when I first started as a service provider, the company didn't want me to touch any of the product side. They said, Randy, I know you know security, but I don't want you touching any of the product side. We don't want to hear any recommendations from your team. And so I felt, well, you know, why not? And they said, well, any security features that you put in may break our product. Our customers are not going to like that. If our customers are not going to like it, they're not going to buy it. And then we're going to have to cut costs. And the best way to get to cut costs is cut people. Would you want to be cut? And so there wasn't really much choice that we had. And the other item that that I've started to notice out there was a lot of the response to our customers who are interested in our security program and want to learn more about our security posture. The service provider said, no, we're not going to share any sensitive documents with you. Any confidential documents we have, like our policies, our network diagram, is not something we're going to send out to you. Trust us on our security posture. We know what we're doing. We have a security guy, reports to the CEO or the executive team. Just don't worry about it. And I think a lot of those customers felt, okay, well, I guess I'm going to have to do it. I realized that the cost savings leads us to move into the service provider. But what can I do? I don't have any other competitors out there today to go to and demand that from them. So there really wasn't any transparency. Now, moving over the years as it passed by, more and more competitors started showing up. Customers now have choices to go to. And if they have one demand that they couldn't go to one provider, they'll bring it over to another provider who would want to win that customer. So that led towards another change in security. Customers have options. Now, the product managers, sales team, other departments in the company said, Randy, we need your help. We need to get ahead of this. We want to prevent some of our customers from having to go to our customers. What additional security controls can we put in place to make these customers happier? So now we're viewed as an enabler for the business, which was an interesting change. And the comment that we, the decision that we left with was, we need to raise the comfort of our customers. We need to make sure that they're comfortable in using our service. And to get them comfortable, the biggest thing that they have to look for is, how do we provide the information that they're looking for? How do we implement the controls that they need in order to use the service? And that led towards more transparency. Let them see the policies. We won't give it to them, but go online, have a WebEx session, look at the policies and see if they're comfortable with it. If they're local, stop on by and have a look at the policies. And that allowed for us to provide more transparency. The other item that I started to notice was that there was a lot more collaboration, not just within the service provider, but also between the cloud users and the cloud service providers. And they were working together to say, look, here's how you can improve security of your product. Now, with the security transitions, there was a lot of lessons learned. I shared the defacement of that one company I used to work for. Customers were impacted by that. Not only were the customers impacted by that, so were the operations people in the service provider. the IT department, the executive team. They remembered that incident. They don't want that to happen again. Customers experience outages, availability outages, whether it's a fiber line cut or an employee within the service provider wanting to do a good thing and accidentally shutting down the Oracle database and causing a huge outage. So there's a lot of lessons that was learned over the years, and that's a lot of that made it into a form of questionnaires. Questionnaires are sent over to the service providers to say, you need to fill this out and respond back. And the response back usually comes back with a, well, additional questions from the customers. But as the company continued to grow, like all the companies I worked for, so did the amount of questionnaires. And the questionnaires weren't the same. There's not one standard questionnaires that were sent out. And finally, requests for evidence continue to grow. We want to see logs. We want to see you changing the root passwords. We want to see the data center that you say the data resides in. Now, every time I say you, it's you, the security program. So earlier I mentioned that working for a service provider, there was a lot of things that I had to be responsible for, including building the security program to protect our company. Then there's external factors that came into this, and that's all of these customer requirements that come in. Questionnaires that would come in and say, we need for you to fill out this list of 200 questions. We would fill it out, send it back to the customer. The customer would say, we don't understand your response. And the reason why they didn't respond or understand the response is because a lot of these questions weren't clear. Some of the questions could be applicable to the internal controls of our company or the controls that we place in our production environment. So the rule of thumb in my company, and I talked to some of my peers about this, and they do the same thing, they respond with just the production side controls, thinking that's what they're more interested in. And that's what creates a lot of confusion. So when the customer says, okay, let's go ahead and sit down and understand this a little bit better, and if they're comfortable with it, then they almost take it to the next step level, which is, let's come on site to do a review. Reviews sometimes last half an hour, could last 3 days. And sometimes they'll have an external review, whether it's a pen tester, Ernst & Young, or another company that they're familiar with to come in and do the work. Now here's another interesting one, which I came across in 2004. I had a customer, a life science organization, that said, Randy, you need to follow the FDA requirements. And I said, well, what FDA are you referring to? And they said, you need to follow the FDA 21 CFR Part 11. And I said, well, we don't handle electronic signature in our environment, so we don't need to comply. And the individual said, look, I have a checkbox here in my list that says any third party that does business with us have to get FDA 21. So we went out and we looked for a company that did it, and it cost about well over $300,000 to get it done. So I went back to the salesperson. I said, look, if you want this company to be our customer, you're going to have to come up with a budget to help us get through this. So a two-week engagement, two people visiting two different sites, a final report came out by this auditor. And one of the things he decided to add, which was out of the norm, was a one-pager at the very top of that page. And it said, based on my review of this company or this service provider, they are not required to follow FDA 21 CFR Part 11. So we took that report in a conference room, gave it to that person. He opened it to the first page, read the three-line paragraph, closed it, and he said, good, we're done. You guys, we can start using your service. And it was just amazing. We have to go through all that process just to get them to sign off on the checkbox. Now, while we're getting all of that requirements from the outside, we have to do a lot of other things at the very top. Staffing resources was an issue. I had a team that's focused on building a security program for the company, protecting the company. But I had all these questionnaires that were coming in and on-site reviews that I have to reallocate resources to and have them manage a lot of our customers. Security budgets, similar to that FDA requirement that our customer has. I've had a lot of customers come in and say, you need to be HIPAA compliant, or you need to follow DICAP, DISCAP, or you need to pursue common criteria, EAL4. The list goes on and on. And some of those cases, we don't do it. And that moves over to the third part of some of the job that we have to do, and that's reducing confusion. And we have to go in and educate some of our customers on why it is that we don't have to comply. And also take that into account and go into the executive team or the sales team within the company and do the same thing. Some of the salespeople, I hate to hit salespeople too hard here, but Some of the salespeople are really focused.